Okay guys, so this is the last video for the Hour of Kwonmunism number 7. And as usual, I like to end my Hour of Kwonmunism with something personal. And let's end a little lighter note. I know this whole hour was me kind of enraged about, you know, not really excited for E3 and just totally just upset about Microsoft's future policies for Xbox One, uncertain about what Sony's gonna do with this PS4, and Obama administration's just ridiculous invasion of violation of our civil liberties, and also the civil liberties of people around the world because of using drones for drone strikes. So This whole hour has been fairly negative. Let's end on a kind of, on a kind of a lighter note. Good thing that happened this week was, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the good stuff. Ouija Waiter is a YouTuber who, he makes awesome YouTube videos. But he has a separate channel which is called The Good Stuff. And It's a project that he does every week. Every week he releases it's set on a theme, and based on that theme, there's a lot of videos. This week's theme was airplanes, and planes and flying and stuff. And his videos are so fantastic. I love it, and I always look forward to the next week of the good stuff because it just started. So I think this is like the second or third theme. I think the first theme that he ever did for the good stuff was origin, you know, origin of life, origin of the universe, and origin of ourselves, how we came to be who we came to be. So, I love it. I think that's awesome. So, I guess I'll try to end this Hour of Kwonmunism with the theme of planes, and talking about my first experience with flying an airplane. It was not a pleasant one, and that's why it's kind of in a negative light. It's not a pleasant one. You know, I was born in Korea, in South Korea, the Republic of Korea. You know, some people always ask me when I meet somebody for the first time, and it's just like, what kind of Asian are you? I'm saying, I'm Korean. Which Korea? What Korea? South Korea or North Korea? South Korea was the country I was born in and immigrated from. It is safe to assume that most Koreans that you meet in America are South Koreans. Most, not always, usually they'll be South Koreans. Because North Korea, if you're born in North Korea, the policies of that country are so that, you know, it is the most totalitarian government that exists in the world today. So, leaving the country is forbidden for its citizens. So it's pretty crazy. You have to escape from that country to go to any other country. So, most North Koreans that you meet, if you ever meet any, are escapees or refugees. If you meet them in America or in any other country. The only time they're not refugees if they're government officials. But I kind of doubt that you'll be talking to a North Korean government official. If you are, you are probably a government official yourself. So that's pretty cool. Props to you for being a government official. Anyway, that whole digression aside, I was born in South Korea. I lived there for about 10 years, and my mom is a bold person. She always wants to. She has this always desire to travel the world, and I think. Even before I was born, she had this desire to go to Saudi Arabia and, you know, be a missionary in Saudi Arabia for a while. I think she's always had that dream for some reason. I'm not her, so I can't really explain why she has had that dream. But she loves to travel and she loves experiencing new things. My dad has like my dad has like the opposite personality. My mom can eat anything and everything. She likes all types of cuisines. My dad, on the other hand, only likes Korean food and only likes like specific Korean food. You know, I mean, he can survive for years with just rice and kimchi, which is the spicy cabbage that is a Korean food. he can survive for years with just that, just rice and spiced cabbage. But he hates all other, he's not really fond of other cuisines. He doesn't like hamburgers, for example. Spaghetti, forget it. You know, he just likes Korean food. So for someone like him, traveling to another world and living in another world, living in another part of the world was kind of out of the question for him. But we have this, my mom is like the head of the household in my family. She's the breadwinner, she's a nurse, and she provided for the family, and she's the most stubborn person in the family. So whatever she says pretty much goes in my family. And she's always wanted to go out of Korea and live somewhere else. She wanted to do that for Saudi Arabia, but that didn't happen. So I think she persuaded my dad to go to America. And my dad was the caretaker, actually. So in my family, the gender roles were always kind of reversed. My dad raised me, and my mom was the breadwinner. My mom was the one going out there in the workplace and making money for the family. That's always kind of how it's been with my family. So I have a closer, like, maternal relationship with my dad than my mom. Even though my mom is much more supportive of me than my dad. My dad is always, you know, like the movie Finding Nemo. Imagine Merlin, the father of Nemo. My dad's always been kind of like the overprotective person. But at the same time, my dad gets disappointed in me more easily, and I feel his disappointment much more so. My mom has always been like, you know, anything kind of goes, you can do whatever you want, and always just supportive. That's kind of the parental relationship that I have with my mom and dad. Anyway, my mom wants to go to America. My dad is thinking of me, so he thinks that America, you know, me having an education in America would be better for me. So he gets persuaded eventually to go to America, but my mom goes first. My mom is a brave, brave woman. From Korea, she goes to America by herself. There's no other family members in America. There's no friends in America. She goes by herself into America and lives in America by herself for about 8 months or even a year by herself. And her English is, at that point, extremely horrible. I mean, it's not really great right now, but at that point in time, I don't know how she survived, but she became a private nurse to this Jewish family. So that's how she got in there. Amazing. And then my dad and I followed her to America about 8 months or about a year later. And I didn't want to go. I actually ran away from home when I found out that we were going to follow mom to America. I ran away from home. But it didn't last long. I felt guilty, like, ran away, and I hung out with my friend, but I didn't tell my friend about anything. I was so sure that I was not going to America. I didn't even tell my friend that I was going away, to America. I mean, I kind of mentioned it, that, like, my parents are planning for us to go to America, but I'm not going. I'm never going. And I had this best friend. It's like, there's no way I'm going. So I didn't even, like, get his contact info or anything. You know, I've never met him since. I hope my best friend at that time is doing okay. But yeah, I was like, I ran away from home, hung out with him for a while, and then I felt really guilty, and so I returned home, and so my dad and I ended up going to America. So that was my first time inside a plane. Was just me coming to America for the very first time. It is a long plane ride. The plane ride is like 8 hours. Not 8 hours. I wish it was 8 hours. It's like 18 hours long, I think. It might be longer. It might be like 20 hours long. It's from Korea over the Pacific Ocean and going over into New York. So we came to New York. The whole plane ride, I didn't actually like the fact that we were in a plane and over a sky, I wasn't even thinking of that. I wasn't conscious of that because I was just so depressed that I was leaving my best friend in my home country and going into this foreign land that I only knew about through TV stations, all the TV shows that I watched in Korea. It's the only reason I knew about America. I didn't know anything about America. So almost the entire plane ride, which is about 18 hours, I was crying throughout the whole ride. I think I fell asleep during the middle of it because crying that long is exhausting. So that's pretty much my flying experience, which is in total contrast to my dad. My dad loves to ride anything. And he loves, when he was young, you know, because you get asked this question, what do you want to be when you grow up? My dad actually said he wanted to be a taxi cab driver. Yeah, he loves driving. He loves riding stuff. He loves roller coasters. He loves being in cars, driving in cars, actually. He prefers to drive than ride, of course. He loves trains, and he loves flying. Imagine this. The whole time, I'm just balled up and crying and crying and crying and whining and just the whole time, right? My dad is looking out the window just completely fascinated, completely in awe of the fact that he is flying. He didn't sleep a single wink during those 18 hours because he was so awed at the fact that he's flying on top of the clouds. And yeah, he didn't sleep at all. He was just like, he was so happy on that airplane. And he still tells me, you know, when I get in the plane, I don't understand how you can fall asleep. This is an amazing thing. You're on top of the skies. You're flying. Human beings aren't supposed to be capable of this, and yet we're on the skies. This is amazing. How can you fall asleep? How can you not enjoy the wonder of being in the skies? That's my dad. He loves writing things. Me, I go in an airplane. The first time I was inside an airplane, yeah, I was just, I cried my whole time. Nowadays, if I get in an airplane to visit my parents, because they're in Tennessee, I'm in New York, usually I take a plane. One time I took a bus. That was quite an experience. But usually take a plane, and inside a plane, I don't know, I don't have my dad's enthusiasm for riding stuff. I hate driving. I don't mind riding in cars, but it's not something I would just opt to do. You know, I would never say that I would become a taxi cab driver when I grow up. That wasn't me. That's not me, you know? So when I get inside the plane, I get a headache. I just the whole feeling of going up to the sky and being in the air, it's not a good feeling for me. So I just try to sleep it off. But it's a very uncomfortable sleep because you're on the plane. Your chair only goes back so far. You go like this, and you have to sleep like this. And then I wake up, and it's jerky, and I wake up with a pain in my neck, and I feel just as tired as when I fall asleep, because sleeping doesn't give me relaxation and actual rest. So I get a good amount of jet lag when I get outside the plane and into my destination, even if the plane ride is actually an hour or 2 hours long. I hate flying. The feeling of flying. I think I fare better in smaller planes. The bigger the plane, the worse it is for me. I like smaller planes, even though smaller planes tend to go, you know, smaller planes tend to be more shaky and jerky. But I like that better, actually, than bigger planes because it gives me a headache. But yeah, that's my personal experience with the first time I ever flew in an airplane. It's not a positive experience because that was that's my immigration story, actually. That's how I came to America. And at the time, I was terrified. I hated the fact that I was coming here. I actually even ran away from home to not come here. And yet, here I am living on my own in New York, right? What irony is this? This is how life works sometimes. So, yeah, thanks for watching. This has been the Hour of Kwonmunism. And yeah, hope you guys enjoyed. Cheers.